Bruce Irving, pastor here at First Christian Church in Bedford, Indiana. I'm here with my wife, Helen Hempfling, the pastor of First Christian Church in Bloomington, Indiana. And on this first Sunday back after surgery, I just want to tell you all that I'm feeling great. And I'm so thankful for all of the cards and emails and phone calls and texts that have come from folks. It's just amazing to be surrounded by the prayers and the love of two congregations.
Amen.
And life is good. And yes, we are back, and we're glad that you're here with us as we pre-record this service so that you can view it in your homes on Sunday and there make a joyful noise unto the Lord.
Now, if you're viewing this live at 10 a.m. Eastern Time on Sunday morning, be sure afterwards, go take a little break, get a cup of coffee, and then come back and be here at 11 o'clock a.m. on Sunday morning, because we have a very special guest with us today. The Reverend Dr. Robert Welsh, former president of the Council on Christian Unity, will be our guest at our Sunday morning forum, talking about how disciples understand baptism and communion and the wonderful gifts that we have to offer to the world in how we receive baptism and communion. A good opportunity for all of us to connect via Zoom, so you might want to check the Facebook page or an email that you would have received this week or your newsletter and come and join us at 11. But just now, let us prepare ourselves for worship.
It's time.
God of mercy, God of grace, show the brightness of thy face. Shine upon us, Savior, shine.
During our time of prayer, we will pause for a brief time of silence, a time when you'll be able to lift up names and places and circumstances to our God of grace. Also, if you have prayer requests, please feel free to email or to phone the church offices during the week and let us know what those concerns are. We have prayer ministry teams that covenant to pray with and for you each and every day. Let us walk along with you with your prayer request. So now, let us sit quietly, take a deep breath, still your hearts, and open yourselves up for a time of prayer. Let us pray. God of mercy, God of grace, God who loves this world, you hold all that you have created within your compassionate embrace, and so we thank you. As you hold our lives, torn by pain, sorrow or hatred within your aching heart, we cry out for wholeness for ourselves, for those we love, for our community, our nation, and this, your world. May your healing presence transform the places of our lives where we hold pain, and also where we, whether or not unknowingly, cause pain. May your grounding presence make itself known for all those who find themselves in despair, lost or alone, vulnerable with little power or voice. May your transforming presence create generosity in place of greed, harmony in place of hatred, racial reconciliation in place of sinful separation, and everlasting justice where evil now reigns. God of mercy, God of grace, God who loves this world, from the depths of our being, we lift up the names of people and places and relationships and situations that need the power of your healing and the power of your loving and transforming and justice-filled presence. So now hear our silent prayers, for we offer them to you. God of mercy, God of grace, God who loves this world, take hold of your world, take hold of us, and do not let us go until all of creation has been blessed and transformed by a vision of love, infinitely generous, bending toward justice, forgiving and freeing, mysterious and profound. May our worship and our lives give glory and honor to you as we claim your power and your presence to make this your world whole. In the name of your Son, who taught us to live and who taught us to pray, saying together, Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. The peace of Christ be with you.
The peace of Christ be with you.
And also with you. We're reading this morning from the Acts of the Apostles, the fourth chapter, verses 32 through 37. Let us listen for the word of God. Now the whole group of those who believed were of one heart and soul, and no one claimed private ownership of any possessions, but everything they owned was held in common. With great power, the apostles gave their testimony to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and great grace was upon them all. There was not a needy person among them, for as many as owned lands or houses sold them and brought the proceeds of what was sold. They laid it at the apostles' feet, and it was distributed to each as any had need. There was a Levite, a native of Cyprus, Joseph, to whom the disciples gave the name Barnabas, which means son of encouragement. He sold a field that belonged to him, then brought the money and laid it at the apostles' feet. The word of God for the people of God. In the summer of 1818, a young family made their way from Kentucky to their new home in the state of Ohio. Thomas and his wife Sarah gathered up their two young children and they headed out to cross the Ohio River. Thomas had already started to carve a farm out of the Jackson County wilderness up there on the north side of the Ohio, and it was there that he and Sarah lived and worked and raised their seven children. Thomas, you see, had brought the land from the federal government on very affordable terms. Some of his new neighbors got an even better deal. They'd been given their land in return for serving in the War of 1812. Several acts of Congress had made this possible. You see, Congress understood that in order for the nation to prosper, its people had to prosper. And the ticket to prosperity was to own land, something that the federal government had in abundance. If you could afford the down payment, the land was yours. It was the first era of wealth sharing in the United States. Wealth sharing. I wonder where they got that idea from. Well, a lot of those congressmen were Christians. In those days, in fact, church services were held right in the House of Representatives. So maybe, just maybe, they got the idea from the Bible. Maybe they even got the idea from the fourth chapter of the book of Acts. Because here we see how the first Christians lived. They shared the wealth so that no one was needy. So powerful was their experience of God's grace that out of their deep trust that the Lord would provide for them, they sold their possessions and held all things in common. Here again, these words from Acts 4, verses 34 and 35. There was not a needy person among them, for as many as owned lands or houses sold them and brought the proceeds of what was sold. They laid it at the apostles' feet, and it was distributed to each as any had need. This is about as down to earth as grace can get. God has freely poured out God's love upon us. God always has, and God always will. God does not do this because of anything that we've done, but simply because it is God's nature to love. God gives us such love as a free gift. That's grace. The early church, then, having been formed and transformed by such grace, having been brought together as a community by such grace, the early church extended grace to each other in the form of material assistance. Everyone received what was needed to be properly housed and clothed and fed. It was a gift to every member of the church. All you had to do was repent and be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ and receive the Holy Spirit. In a time of economic scarcity, it was one heck of an evangelistic technique. With the heavy knee of the Roman Empire on nearly everyone's throat, most people were poor. But there were some merchants and property owners among those first Christians, people whom we might think of as middle or even upper class, and they shared what they had, making sure that everyone in the church had the necessities of life. Wealth that was owned by the community was made available to each individual and family for the common good. Here we have both a practice of the early church and a principle of the kingdom of God. Here we have a manifestation of Christian life in the first century and a prophetic call for the 21st century. If the first Christians believed anything, they believed in the common good. If one member suffers, all suffer together. If one member is honored, all rejoice together. That's how St. Paul put it in 1 Corinthians 12. Within the community, you see, we take care of each other. That's a norm of grace deeply embedded in the Bible, firmly rooted in Hoosier soil, and enshrined in the Constitution's stated purpose to promote the general welfare and secure the blessings of liberty for all. There have been three eras of wealth sharing in U.S. history. The first was the aforementioned sale of public land to settlers in Indiana and Ohio and elsewhere in the Northwest Territory. My forebears, and I'm sure many of yours, got clear title to property for maybe the first time in their lives. These were hard-working Scots-Irish folk, Thomas and Sarah Irvine among them, because, yes, that opening story was the story of my great-great-great-grandparents. Hard-working folks, but they got the title to the land before they had done any of the work. You had to get the deed before you could till the soil. You received land from the federal government. They had received land from the federal government, not as a reward for work done, but as an investment, given in trust that hard work would follow. It's kind of like grace, freely given by God in trust that a heart transformed by grace will in turn be engaged in building up the community and looking after the needs of others. The second era of wealth sharing was launched by the Homestead Act in 1862. Now a family could get land for free. You just had to work it for 5 years. Again, not a reward for work done, but an investment in trust for work to be done. I dare say that without these acts of generosity on the part of the federal government, without these biblically inspired eras of wealth sharing, many of our forebears and we ourselves would never have made it into the middle class, because again, owning property was the ticket to prosperity in the 19th century. The third era of wealth sharing was the New Deal, including Social Security, federally insured mortgages, and government grants to returning veterans so that they could go to school or start a business. These investments propelled even more Americans into the middle class, including my GI dad and perhaps your dads and granddads as well. But here's the thing. African Americans were systematically barred from participating in these programs. In 1800, the vast majority of Black Americans were enslaved and couldn't make it across the Ohio River. By 1880, when my great-grandparents were homesteading out in Nebraska, most Black Americans had been all but re-enslaved as sharecroppers, and they couldn't make it out to the Great Plains. And African Americans were cut off from the benefits of the New Deal and the GI Bill because of a bargain made between President Roosevelt and the Southern Democrats. The Dixiecrats would support New Deal wealth sharing so long as the benefits did not go to Black folks. So farm and domestic workers could not participate in Social Security. That would be Black sharecroppers and house cleaners. Most Black veterans were disqualified from the benefits of the GI Bill. And entire Black neighborhoods were disqualified from receiving the federal mortgages that would have permitted them to buy a home in a crime-free suburb with good schools and quiet places to do homework. Add to this some other forms of housing discrimination as well as employment discrimination, and you see that to this day, far too many African Americans are trapped on public assistance and low-paying jobs, not because they are unwilling to work, but because they have been systematically barred from the highway to prosperity. The Bible calls that injustice. The Bible calls that a sinful refusal to structure society according to the norms of the kingdom of God. I mean, after working hard as slaves for 250 years, the least that we could have done in 1865 was to give those folks, each of their families, 40 acres and a mule. Thomas and Sarah Irvine got 320 acres for crying out loud, and they hadn't even worked the land yet. What we need in the United States is a fourth era of wealth sharing. Only this time, it won't be investments for work to be done, but a debt that is owed for work
already done. Work in the fields, work in people's homes, hard work in the only low-paying jobs that African Americans had access to. What we need in the United States are investments in small-town and inner-city schools and in apprenticeship programs and in post-secondary education, investments for all Americans, but especially for Black Americans. Sharing the wealth is a biblical norm. It was one of the first practices of the first Christians. Those with property recognized that they had received wealth from a gracious God, and in gratitude, they generously shared that wealth with those in need. We worship a God who offers us not a cheap grace, but a very costly and down-to-earth grace. Acts of justice and generosity are expected, and indeed they will come when we repent and receive the Holy Spirit. Amen. So I got to tell you, those first Christians, they took their generosity very seriously. I mean, they offered to the church all of their assets. When we talk about tithing, we're only talking about 10% of your income. I mean, that's a bargain, eh? We have freely received. Let us freely give.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow.
Let us pray. By your grace, O God, receive these gifts offered in gratitude and humility for the upbuilding of your kingdom on earth, your kingdom where wealth is shared, love abounds, peace reigns, and needs are met. We offer our gifts as we recall with the Apostle Paul Jesus' words, "It is more blessed to give than to receive." May it be so. Amen. Every time we come to the table of the Lord, we are reminded that Jesus held nothing back, that he offered all that he had, shared all of his wealth, and it continued to do so, continues to do so, and will do so forever. Yes, here at this table, we are reminded of God's giving that has no ending. And yes, here at this table, the richness is offered to all, the richness of grace and compassion, the richness of welcome and acceptance, the richness of mercy and love, where all needs are met. And here, a place has been set for you. Yes, you. So come. Come as you are. Partake in what has been freely offered and share in the fullness of life that is for all. And give thanks to God, remembering how Jesus, when he gathered with his friends, took bread and gave thanks and broke it and gave it to them, saying, "This is my body, it is broken for you." And in the same manner, he took a cup and after giving thanks, gave it to them, saying, "This cup is a new covenant, a new promise in my blood poured out for many for forgiveness of sins. So take and drink it, all of you, and remember me. Let us pray.
Bless, O Lord, these elements with the power of your Holy Spirit, the power of the Spirit of the risen Christ. So bless them that they may fortify us in your service, that we may go forth from this table empowered to seek the kingdom of God and its righteousness. For it is in the name of the risen Christ that we pray. Amen.
We invite you to hold the bread and the cup as a choir sings its anthem. And then when we are finished, let us partake of these elements together. The table is ready. It's for you. Let us commune with the risen Christ. The bread of life for you. Take and eat.
The cup of life poured out for the whole world. All of you, drink of it.
Let us pray. Thank you, God, for your presence here and now. Thank you, Christ Jesus, for gathering us together as one by the power of your love that transcends time and space. Indeed, we do rejoice and are glad in you. As we leave this, your table, we are renewed by your Spirit to love one another, to share freely and generously, and to live according to what we have received by our fellowship with you around your table of grace. Hear this, our prayer, for we offer it in the name of Christ Jesus. Amen. Amen.
Thank you for joining with us this Sunday morning. We invite you to stay with us. The adult forum on disciples' identity will be available to us live at 11 a.m. Eastern Daylight Savings Time. Our guest today is going to be the Reverend Dr. Robert Welsh, who's the former president of the Council on Christian Unity. He's going to help us reflect on a disciple's understanding of baptism and communion.
And for those of you who are members of First Christian Church Bloomington, we invite you to vote for our new board members. They were offered to you through a newsletter and through a couple of emails you received. And the voting is today. It's open till 9 p.m. through responding to the email message or by calling the church and issuing, letting us know your vote. Now, friends, let us with one voice sing our closing hymn. Someone has said that we are to pray as if the coming of the kingdom depends totally on God and to work as if it depends totally on us. To do so is part of what it means to be a partner in Christ's service. And so as we go forth into the world this week, I encourage you to pray for the kingdom and to seek through your words and your deeds the kingdom of God, and to do so in the hope that the day will come when the wealth of the whole world will be shared equitably with all. And so as you go, may God bless you and keep you. May God's face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May God look upon you with kindness and give you peace. Amen.